This conference will now be recorded.
Oh, cool, I'm being recorded. Okay, so I've got negative pressure and positive pressure, right? So negative pressure on the left side, if we remember, we're trying to pull smoke out of a building. So we're gonna get this set up in a window. Like I said, we really wanna try to seal this fan. Here it's taking up most of the window, and that's kinda accomplishing what we want it to do, right? We want this again on the leeward side of the window. If we're trying to get the smoke out and then the wind just blows it back in, we're not doing a super effective job here. Positive pressure ventilation is pushing air into a building, creating slightly higher pressure so that it influences all of the air, smoke, all of the bad stuff inside of that building to leave. If you'll notice here, we've got this fun little arrow. The reason for that is we want to try to create almost a cone of air going around that doorway going into the house. So once you set your fan, you can actually walk up to that door and feel with your hand the top and the bottom. Make sure air is kind of encapsulating that whole doorway. So the thought here is that we take all of the air that we can and we shove it into that room, increasing the pressure, giving everything else a reason to leave inside of the building. Do you have any questions about how either of these two are set up? Cool. Let's watch some hydraulic ventilation. So as you can see, pretty tough to see in this burn building. Now they open a window. And now we've got this fog stream going, and it's pretty much taken up that whole window. So just watch the smoke movement around kind of that light. You see how fast that's kind of blowing out of that room? It is pretty incredible once you can see it in real life and we start playing around with it. But I mean, look at the visibility in this room since they started doing that, right? It's pretty much clear now. They're gonna switch off and give this dude some nozzle time. But any questions on why that worked, how to employ it, anything with horizontal ventilation before we start moving into roofs and vertical vent? Okay. Dive into it. So again, I know you guys did your building construction, but I just really want to make sure we get our terminology locked down here before we start moving on. The ridge board is going to be that line kind of at the peak of the roof. We've got hips leading up to it. They're typically going to be diagonal from the end of the span meeting in the middle at the ridge. And then we've got the eaves. So eaves are kind of if you think about how a roof is built, we'll kind of look at the anatomy of it in the next slide. But we've got a rafter plate, which goes around the walls, and then the rafters are sort of secured into it, and then they go up to the ridge, but they also extend down past that wall. The eaves are that space between the rafter plate and where the rafters end, or the end of the roof, and the soffit is kind of the underside of that. Does that make sense to everybody? Just stop me if it's starting to get confusing. So if we look at the anatomy of a roof here, this is gonna be really important when we start talking about where we cut, how we sound, stuff like that. We've got these rafters running up to the ridge board like we just talked about that. On top of that, we've got decking. So this is usually gonna be plywood or OSB. I'm not sure if you guys hit on the differences between OSB and ply or engineered lumber in your building construction stuff. Let me know if you didn't, and we can kind of go into it. But essentially, OSB engineered wood is going to give us less time. And then on top of that decking, we're going to have our shingles. If you're in Timberline, we'll probably have a metal roof, whatever they put up there, tile, stone, whatever it might be. So rafters, decking on top of rafters, shingles on top of decking. And this is what a truss design kind of looks like. So as we can see, we've got these kind of triangles going down this whole wall. Where does this weight get distributed of the roof? What is kind of the thought here behind putting triangles up? Does anybody know? Okay, so
you distribute the weight.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was just saying you distribute the weight when you do the triangle shape type thing.
Yeah, totally. So the goal behind putting all these triangles up is that we distribute the weight, and the way that that weight is going to flow, it's going to go down the side of the triangle into the rafter plate, into the load bearing wall, and then into the ground, right? That's kind of the thought behind why we build roofs this way. The strongest part of that wall essentially is going to be where that rafter plate meets the wall. We'll talk about that in a little bit here, but I just wanted to kind of give you guys a good view of what the bones kind of look like of a roof. Who can give a guess as to what part of this construction will fail first, typically in a fire? All right, that's fine. We don't have anything. So I guess another kind of thing that we constantly want to be thinking about in the fire service is where's our points of weakness, right? This comes into play a lot in forcible entry, but it also comes into play in building construction and when we're actually getting up on a roof. So if we're looking at this roof, gusset plates are usually going to be the first thing to fail in a fire. So those are those metal kind of plates that are securing this whole truss design together. So that's usually not a super great thing for us because it's kind of holding this whole system together. When we talk about the trusses themselves, we can have these made out of 2x4, 2x6, 2x8. Who can tell me the difference between a 2x4 and a 2x8 as it relates to us being on the roof? Like, why do we care what those trusses are made out of?
A 2x8's gonna support more weight, I think, than 2x4.
Yeah, agreed. It's gonna support more weight, and it's also gonna give us more time. So a lot of what we do in the fire service is also gonna revolve around time, right? So if you were to take a 2x8 and 2x4 and bring them into your backyard and burn them, it's gonna take a lot longer for that 2x8 to fail. That's the thought behind this. So if we can tell what those trusses are made out of, it starts to give us kind of a mental picture of how long we have to be up on that roof in terms of a 2x4 versus a 2x8. And that's going to typically play into your officer's decision making once you're up on that roof, or the IC's decision making to put you up on that roof in general. The last one I kind of wanted to hit on here was sort of the compartmentalization that this creates. So if we're up on the roof, we've got kind of these different compartments between truss spaces, right? If one truss goes down over on the other side of the roof, it doesn't mean that the roof is totally not viable now. It just means that that truss section is not viable. That doesn't mean that you should continue hanging out on that roof until the end of the call, but keep that in mind that if a truss goes down on the Bravo side, maybe we just need to move to the Charlie side if that's an effective place to ventilate. It's also a reason to tell the IC, because that might impact what the engine company is doing down below. But really the main point of this slide was to just give you a good idea of what the skeleton of a roof looks like, talk a little bit about what's going to fail first, and then give us more time in terms of what was used to construct this roof. Questions on those three building construction slides before we get into our tactics? Cool.
If you're up on a roof, how would you describe your location if you're kind of between, like, say, the Bravo and Charlie side, kind of somewhere in the center?
I mean, you can just say I'm in the center of the roof, right? If you've got any kind of landmarks to yell out, go for it. But yeah, if you're right in the center of the roof, just say I'm in the center, like tending towards Charlie or tending towards Bravo. Like, you don't have to give it your exact coordinates all the time, but something to give the IC a good picture. Cap, I don't know if you have anything you like to hear firefighters say for stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, you describe it as best you can. Again, orienting yourself when you get on scene to know where the alpha site is, just so you can kind of give references to where you're at. The roof is a little bit hard because you're kind of on a different plane than everyone else. But just, you know, do your best, and we'll talk about when you're in zero visibility and you're crawling around a building, or you're doing a especially when you're doing a search, like, even though you can't see, you need to kind of have a mental picture in your head of where you are, where you came in the building, where you currently are at all times, because if something happens to you, you want to be able to give the people that are going to come help you the best location so they get to you quickly. And that's just a learned skill of being able to give directions of where you're at. I definitely haven't spent enough time on a roof to be really good at it, but like Tommy says, you know, pick a reference or, you know, orient yourself according to that alpha side and do your best. Yeah, that's what I got.
Yeah, that's kind of tough. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, it just kind of visualizing it seemed like it might be something to hard to somewhat describe at the moment.
Yeah, totally. I mean, other stuff too that the IC might be able to see from the ground, like if there's a chimney there, you can say I'm by the chimney, whatever else. But yeah, I mean, that's kind of tough, but as Cav said, let's just try to stay oriented and kind of describe it the best you can. So this is kind of a bigger slide, but it's important. So let's talk about the size up for vertical vent. So the first thing we want to try to figure out is how is this roof built? One of the things that we can try to look at is rafter tails. So a lot of times when we're building roofs, it used to look super cool to continue the rafters through the eaves and then sort of leave that kind of exposed on the bottom. So if that's the case, you can look up, you can actually see which way those rafters are going. You can see the spacing, you can see what they're built out of, whether it's a 2x4 or a 2x8. You can get a general idea of what you're about to kind of hop up on. So if you've got a chance to look at that, take it, make a note of it, let your crew know that's what you're getting up onto. The second major thing here, and this is kind of right when we're starting to get up onto this roof, is weakened roof members. So those two
members. My roof
members,
has the rafters sticking out. I'm trying to angle it so you can see it.
Oh, you got your video on? Sweet. Oh, yeah.
You see,
nice.
Like, the ridge kind of sticking out past.
Yeah, for sure. Awesome. Thanks for sharing that. Cool. So, back to our weakened roof members here. If we think about our anatomy of the roof slide, we've got two things that we really want to watch out for. First is our rafters, second is our decking. I personally care less about rafters and care more about decking, but let's talk about it. So rafters, what we can start to see is sinking from the ridge to the rafter plate. So if we know, because we just looked at our rafter tails, that our rafters are going this way and we start to see a dip like that in the roof, we know, hey, maybe our rafters are not looking super great right now. Decking, in my opinion, is a whole lot more important, and it's a whole lot easier to see. So if we start seeing sinking, or we're up on the roof and we're able to actually see where those rafters are positioned, we call this like waffling. So we can actually tell where our rafters are at. That means our decking has started to kind of sink down, and maybe it's not the best roof to hang out on. The second one is smoke coming out of the middle of the roof. So if you think about like last week when it was raining and snowing, I'm guessing that a lot of you guys probably didn't go toss a bunch of buckets underneath like your roof to catch all the water coming through, because it wasn't coming through, right? Roofs are built, or they should be built, to be watertight. So the same concept kind of goes with smoke, right? If we're up on a roof and we see smoke coming out of the middle of the roof, something's wrong, right? That decking is probably failed, or there's a hole somewhere we don't know about. There might be fire in the attic that's already eaten away. Just look out for stuff like that when you're up on a roof. The final thing that we want to keep in mind here for size up would be load. So we've got two types of load up on a roof. We've got live load. This is us. This is what we bring up on the roof, our ladders, our saws, everything that we bring up there. And we are definitely heavy. And then we've got our dead load, right? This is stuff that kind of like hangs out on the roof. So this is all of the components of its construction. This is HVAC stuff that's mounted up there. This is any other heavy materials. It's also stuff like solar panels. We really want to just be cautious of what our dead load is before we step on there. If we've got tons of HVAC equipment on a wood frame, we know that that roof is probably already taken a ton of weight already. So we should just take that into consideration, right? And the second part of live load, if we go back to that, we live in Colorado, so we always have to be kind of cautious of snow and the weather elements up on the roof, whether that's ice or snow. I know we don't get a lot of it up at Timberline, so yeah. Let's talk about cutting and moving, right? Our next slide will go into sounding really in depth, but what I want to hit on here is that we need to sound everywhere that we go. So before your foot hits a spot on the roof, a tool should have hit it first. So when we're walking down the roof, we want to sound, sound, sound. We're going to go in a semicircle pattern, and we want to hit the roof, like drive your tool into the roof hard. We'll talk about what we're actually doing and why we're doing it in the next slide. But anytime you're walking on a roof, your tool should have hit before you did. When we're moving on a roof, we want to try to move in 90 degree angles. So if we think back to how that truss construction was, the strongest parts of the roof are in 90 degree angles. So you've got that load bearing wall where the rafter plate connects to it. That's typically going to be your strongest part of the roof. And then we've got rafters running up at 90 degrees to that. So if we can, we want to stay walking on that load bearing wall or close to it. And then we want to move up at a 90 degree angle on a structural member, right? That's kind of always our goal when we're moving on a roof, to stay on strong structural members. The ridge would seem like a good option to move along. It's usually going to be a beefier board than the rafters are. So if rafters are 2x4, the ridge is usually going to be a 2x8. The issue is that with newer construction, sometimes we're not continuing rafters all the way up to that ridge board, and there's going to be vents in place, and that could even just be shingles up there with no decking. So that's not usually a great place to hang out. Avoid that if you can. Distributing your weight is super important. Like we said before, we want to try to stay on structural members, but at the same time, we want to try to spread out where we're walking. And if stuff starts to get really bad, like if you're falling through a roof, we want to try to roll out of that because it best distributes our weight. That's the whole kind of concept behind putting a roof ladder up on the roof. It expands where our footprint is on that roof, and it spreads it out so that we're not all in one spot, if that kind of makes sense. Bird dogging the pitch. Again, this is big from Jason Brewer. It's a great point. So what this means is if we are walking on a roof, as we're kind of making our way along this roof, as we're trying to figure out where we want to cut, we want to go up to that ridge and take a peek over it. We don't need to hang out there for a while or move along that ridge. We just talked about that, but we want to take a look over the pitch. Let's talk about why. Anyone have any ideas?
Is it to be able to see if there's any, if it's like, I guess you could be able to tell if it's still straight and still holding strong, or if it's being effective and it's starting to lose its strength?
Yeah, totally. So let's think back to that picture of truss construction, right? So if we can see the other side of the truss, that's a pretty good mirror of what's going on our side of the truss. So if that side of the truss has, I don't know, some kind of signs like you were just talking about of it weakening, or if we see fire down there, we know that we're probably not in the best spot and we might want to reevaluate what we're doing. So if we think about fire again, it wants to ride those trusses up. So if we see a fire directly opposite from us on the other side of the pitch, we know that maybe we're not in the best compartment here and that fire is going to want to ride up to the ridge, up towards where we are, and maybe we have to reevaluate kind of where we are on this roof or where we want to move to. Does that kind of make sense? Cool. Questions on size up and cutting and moving before we dive into sounding? All right. So this is IFSTA's one and only slide on sounding, and it's wildly helpful, but I thought I might just expand on it a little bit more. So let's kind of try to have a conversation here. Besides John and Steven, who are like the only two that are talking. So let's try to figure out why we sound. Why do we think that we're sounding when we get up onto a roof?
To see if there's any like weak points or anything?
Yeah. Anything else? I mean, yeah, Tyler, you kind of hit it there, right? So we're checking to see if this roof can sustain us, right? If we're good to be up on this roof. So why do we use sounding to kind of accomplish that? Like, what does slamming a tool on the roof actually do for us? Anybody got any guesses there?
You might be able to hear if it's like hollow or like kind of weak in that area, or if the tool just goes through it, would not be a good thing.
Yeah, definitely not super great if our tool just goes through the roof, for sure. But yeah, I mean, you're on it. So I think your book, I don't really remember this chapter to be honest, but I think your book is going to talk about feeling rafters. That is complete crap. I don't go on enough roofs. Even like Denver guys don't go on enough roofs to try to feel rafters if you're dropping an axe on a roof or a hook or whatever, right? Roofs are kind of built to sustain that. So if you're on a roof and you're sounding and you think you feel the rafters, that should probably just tell you that you got bad decking, right? And it should feed into what you're doing, absolutely. But what we're really trying to do here is feel differences. So when we get on the roof, we want to get a baseline. So like Tyler was talking about, maybe that's a sound. It's probably going to be a feel, right? So as we're sounding along, if it's like boom, 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 and then all of a sudden like hollow, like Tyler was talking about, that's something to consider. Another thing too, and probably easier to feel and a more telltale sign, would be the feel of the roof. So we get on, we honestly don't care how much experience we've got on the roofs, right? We should know what we're doing, but if we get off that ladder and it's like sound, 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 block, sound, 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 sound. All of a sudden you hit something and you're like, oh, that was kind of squishy, or that was a little bit softer than where we were before. We know that we're kind of getting into a worse territory here. That should be kind of reason to stop and reevaluate what we're really doing here. So sounding here, a little bit misleading with the term. It should really be called feeling, but whatever. We're trying to differentiate a baseline, and we're going to talk about how we do that in terms of our tactics moving in a couple slides. But does anybody have questions on sounding? This is one of the most important things that we can talk about for vertical ventilation. We always have to be super careful about sounding so that we don't start falling through the roofs.
I think one other point to kind of tie in with sounding is, if you're sounding every single step you're taking, how long should you be on the roof? For as little time as possible. As soon as you cut your hole, it's not, yeah, you know, in the movies or in videos, you watch people admire their work and they stay up there forever. I am of the mindset of, I go up there, I do my job, and I get off the roof. There's just so many things that can go wrong. So, and especially if I'm having the sound for, you know, every step that I'm taking, I want to go up there, get my job done, and then get off the roof. So just think about it in time, in a time frame sense. I'm up there doing urgent work that needs to be done, and then I get off.
So let's talk about some positions and tools. So our positions are going to be a little bit more in depth than vertical ventilation, because we're going to be up on a roof. There's a lot more moving parts. It's more complex. Officer is going to be the eyes, ears, and the mouth up on the roof. The saw position is going to make our cuts, obviously, and then a clean out position is going to kind of move that material that the saw just cut. So let's talk about how this kind of plays out. What the officer does is kind of up to the discretion of the fire department. We don't have a super good method flushed out yet at Timberline, to be honest. In my ideal world, we're working in a crew of three. Our officer is the first person on the roof, right? He's got his tick. He's sounding for everyone. He's going to sound all the way up to where we need to cut. He's going to make some kind of indicator, whether he smashes that tool deeper into the roof or if he just looks at the firefighter and he's like, yeah, this is where you should cut it. He's going to kind of get to that hole, make sure that everyone behind him is good in terms of walking to get to it. And then he's going to get out of the way, or she's going to get out of the way. And the reason why we need her to be back from the people making the cuts is it's super hard to communicate or hear on the radio if you've got a saw running right next to you. The officer needs to be kind of like the eyes in the sky here. They need to take a big picture view of what's actually going on the roof so they can see, hey, maybe this roof is starting to fail behind where my saw position firefighter is making his cut. Maybe we should move across. Maybe the officer goes and checks over the pitch and all of a sudden that side of the roof is on fire. They need to be kind of on top of stuff, and they can't be sucked into these two positions, being the saw and the cleanout. Saw position is relatively straightforward. They're going to go up there and they're going to make the cut. Cleanout is going to take a long tool and it's going to pull that cut material out of the way. Sometimes this can be switched off on one person. So the way that this would look is the saw person goes up, they make their cuts, whatever. They turn around, hand the saw back to the cleanout person who's behind them. Cleanout person gives them a tool. They then take that tool and use it to clean out what they just cut. Again, we don't really have it super fleshed out, but those are going to be the three main positions that we have up on the roof. In terms of tools, going back to long tools again, right? A hook is going to be super awesome up on the roof, as is like a 6-foot trash hook. The pike pole, it's what we got, so we got to use it. We need to have a long tool here, a couple of reasons. So the first is, once we make our cuts, We don't want to be leaning over that hole to try to pull it out, right? It gives us some distance back from where we just made those cuts to actually move that material. The second would be to punch the ceiling. If we make a cut in the roof, that's all well and good, but if we really do want that smoke and heat and everything to come up and out, we're gonna have a ceiling in our way. So it's awesome if you got a huge hole in the roof, but if you didn't punch the ceiling, it's not doing any good. So if you look under that clean out position, punch the ceiling when ready is a huge caveat there. So we want to make sure that that engine company is in place and ready and everything is coordinated before we punch that ceiling, because once we do, it's game on. So this can happen in a couple of ways, right? The engine can ask for it. They can tell you when they're ready to punch the ceiling, or your officer is going to be listening to the radio. Now, ideally, like Cap said, this is all going to be coordinated and it's going to be quick. Our ventilation team's going to be going up on the roof as our engine company is making the stretch, and then everything's going to kind of flow. So if you can hear on the radio, the engine company is like, hey, we're getting to the fire room, you're probably good to go ahead and punch through that ceiling. But we need to make sure that we wait for the engine company to be ready before we actually start rocking all this thing. Otherwise, we're going to do more harm than good. Saws, pretty straightforward, right? We need a saw up on the roof. So we've got chainsaws and K-12s. Let your roof material dictate what you actually bring up onto the roof. So if we've got a wood frame with shingles, a chainsaw is going to be super effective. If we're cutting a metal roof on a commercial structure or a residential structure, K-12 might be a better option. Chainsaws can also cut through that, but kind of let your what's going on with the fire and what's going on with your building construction dictate that for you. The other main camp here would be a tile roof. We typically use like a sledge or a flathead axe to smash those tiles through and then actually gain access to the decking below, if that makes sense. The next bullet here is for a flatheaded axe. So anytime we're going up on the roof with saws, if we need this operation to be quick, we need to be thinking about backups. So if we actually need a hole in this roof, I don't know about you guys, but I've never had a flathead axe not start. So if we're up there and I'm trying to start my chainsaw, or if I got it running on the ground like I should have and then carried it up onto the roof and then it runs out of gas, at least we've got our flatheaded axe there to help us out. While our engineer goes and grabs us a second saw or more gas or whatever it is that we might need, we can even probably finish that hole before we get that back up there. So if we have to revert to using this flatheaded axe, instead of using our point, let's flip around and use the flathead side. And we're gonna almost do this like a hammer, right? It might seem like pretty brutal, but it actually goes really quickly. So the first few hits suck, and then you can pretty well kind of break through that roof and do what you got to do. So we need to have a flathead axe up there all the time as a backup for our saws. Ladders, we're going to talk about placement in a little bit, but we've got our two main ladders here, right? We've got our 24 extension, that's how we actually get up to the roof, and then we've got our roof ladder, and we can use this again for spreading out our weight. It can be kind of an anchor point on the roof if we need it. And it can serve as a placeholder for our tools. So if we've got a really steep roof, that ladder can both aid us in not slipping, and we can also put our saws and stuff on there so that we don't drop something straight onto the ground. The tick we kind of talked about already, but this is going to be the officer's main tool here, right? He's going to be using this tick to look for hot spots in the roof before you even step on it. He can even look down through the roof, see what we got underneath it if he needs to. But we'll talk about that in a second. So questions on positions, tools, anything like that? Cool. Let's talk about ladders and where we actually want to cut. So your book's going to say 3 to 5 rungs up. Anyone guess why we actually want to have this ladder up higher than the line of the roof?
You guys know this.
There's a couple of reasons. I know one of them is for safe egress. So if somebody's looking to get off of the roof, they don't have to look for just the tip of the ladder. They can actually see the ladder, but also it makes it easier to get on and off the roof if you have, I guess, enough rungs and enough ladder or the beams to grab onto before you hop around to start climbing down.
Textbook, Stephen. Yeah, you nail it. The main reason for putting our ladder up 3 to 5 rungs is so that we can actually see it and smoke, right? If we've got our ladder right at the roof line and we make our cut and there's smoke pouring out of that because we did an awesome job, it's going to be really hard to find that ladder again and to climb back down on it. Roof ladder, we just sort of talked about a little bit. It disperses our weight. It also holds our tools. Super helpful tool up on the roof if we can get it. We want to have a primary extension and a secondary extension. So we always need to have a second way to get off of this roof if stuff goes bad and we can't get back to where we started from. So when we talk about where we want to cut, we want to think back again onto why we're actually employing this tactic, right? This is to support the engine company, right? This is to lift heat, to lift smoke, to make their lives easier so that they can see. If we're cutting right above the fire, perfect. We're giving all of that stuff a route to get out of the house. If we're not, we can potentially influence more fire to move around that house. That's a big point if we've got victims, right? So if we came to this house and you've got a truck company inside doing a primary and an engine company making a stretch, and you hear the mother outside saying that her daughter is in the back bedroom, we want to try to A, figure out where that might be on a 360, B, gain some intelligence from the people inside of the building, and C, we want to take note of that when we're up on the roof. So if we know that her bedroom's in the Bravo Charlie corner, we want to try to cut away from that, right? If the fire is not by her, great. If it is by her, we want to be really tactical about where we're actually cutting so that we make sure we don't cut right on top of her. Consider wind when we're up there too. If you get up there and it's like a tornado, feel free to voice that to the IC. If that's going to impact your fire conditions inside, it's definitely not something that we want to do. Again, we've mentioned this a couple of times. But where's our fire now and where is it going to? We need to always consider this every time we're up on the roof, because if we decide to make a cut somewhere and then fire starts growing behind us and we don't have a ladder anywhere near us, we're going to be in a really bad spot. Or if we make our cut on one side of the roof and we forgot to check the other and it looks like that truss is actually on fire, now we're in an even worse spot, right? So always take into account where the fire is and where it's going to next. This should always be going through your brain. Finally, think about your exposures, right? So both internal and external, we kind of talked about internal exposures a little bit already. This would be spreading fire to other areas of the house. External, if we make our hole in the roof, we ideally want to start bringing fire out of that hole. So are you going to set anything on fire on top of you? Is it going to impact the neighbor's house? Stuff like that. And that doesn't necessarily mean stop, right? It just means we have to figure out what we want to do about it. So do we have an exposure line in place? Does the IC know that, hey, this might actually impact the neighbor's house? Do we have enough resources to take care of that if it does? Stuff like that. Questions on ladders, where we cut, stuff like that. We're going to go into ladder placement next. Sweet. Okay, this is IFSTA's slide on ladder placement. What do we think? Do we like this setup? Do we not like this setup? Do we like primaries and secondaries? What are we thinking?
Yeah, I think it's good. I think the secondary might be better if it was a little bit closer to the primary on that wall that it's already on, but I don't know. I think it's good.
Cool. Anyone else?
I guess, do you always have to have just a primary and secondary, or can you do additional escape means, have one on another side on a Charlie Delta? Do you only have to have two, or can you have multiple options?
That's a great question. I would say empty the ladder beds of every apparatus that you got on scene. If we can get ladders all around this roof, that's sweet. If we can get ladders to all of our windows, that's even better. Again, we want to make sure that we're not really getting in the way of engine company inside or anyone else on the grounds. But yeah, absolutely, we can use more than two ladders. Any other thoughts on this before we go into what I got on ladder positioning? So here's what I think. Big thumbs down on this guy here. I hate this setup, and it's not because we got two ladders. I love that. We do need two ladders. It's because IFSTA got the positioning wrong. So this is what I want it to look like. Again, this is big from Jason Brewer. He kind of flipped this in my mind, but if we start thinking about putting our primary ladder further away from our hole and our secondary ladder closer, it does a couple of things. So the first one would be that a secondary ladder should be something you go to if you can't get back the way that you came. Let's look at this slide. If you come up your primary ladder, if something goes wrong, you're like, okay, sweet. We got a secondary ladder. We just got to run across the entire roof and get to it, and then we'll get down. Doesn't make any sense, right? Your secondary ladder should be closer. And that might seem like semantics, but what actually matters here is that if you set your primary ladder further away from where you're going, it gives yourself the ability to set a baseline. So when we talked about sounding, we're going to sound for feel and maybe sound too. So if we get on this ladder really close to the fire, it gives us a couple of disadvantages, right? The first would be that we're pulling smoke and fire out of this hole, and it's going to impact us finding our way back to that ladder. We already kind of talked about it, but it also takes away our ability to start to get a baseline of what's going on this roof. So if we get on the primary from a little bit further away and give ourselves some travel distance, and I'm not talking about traveling the entire roof, like we do want to have consideration for getting up, getting our job done, and getting down. But we need to give ourselves a chance to feel what a good roof feels like. So we give ourselves time to say, hey, when I first sounded this, when I got on the ladder, it felt solid, and now it feels a little bit spongy as I'm moving down this wall. It gives us more time to get a baseline of what the roof was like and where it's headed as we're moving towards that hole. Does that make sense? So just to clarify here, we absolutely need a secondary ladder, and it would be sweet to have a third ladder or a fourth ladder, however many ladders. But we do want to give ourselves some time to actually get a good baseline of what this roof feels like before we kind of move down it. Does that make sense? All right. Let's talk about cuts. Definitely the most fun part about vertical ventilation. We get to use a chainsaw, and they're super fun and powerful. So we got three kind of camps here, right? We got inspection cuts, vent cuts, and a trench cut. So if we dig into inspection cuts a little bit, we're going to have this initial cut here, and it's going to be kind of like a triangle. So we're going to get up on that roof. We're going to make our inspection cut as a triangle, and it's going to be relatively big. So what this does for us is a couple of things. First, it lets us see kind of what is happening underneath our roof. Is there fire that's crept up into the attic? Is there fire right below us? Is it totally clear in the attic? It gives us kind of an early indication of what we're kind of walking over. The second thing it does is if we make that hole, that triangle big enough, and this can be a really quick three cuts, we can actually tell what kind of construction is underneath us, right? What happened when you made that cut? Were you rolling over rafters? What was the spacing like? How big are the rafters underneath it? Take a quick peek into that hole and check and just see if you can tell anything about your construction, whether that's rafter spacing, whether it's 2x4s, 2x6s, 2x8s, is your decking OSB, is it plywood? There's a lot that you can tell from doing that, right? So pay attention to what happens to fire conditions when you make that cut. Is there smoke blowing out? Is there no smoke? Is there fire? And then what is going on with the building construction when we make that cut? As we're walking, or once we get close to our hole, or once we're at our hole, we can make a kerf cut. So basically this is just a line, and it's gonna tell us what's happening with fire conditions underneath us at that second. So this is a super quick cut, but it's also super helpful, right? So we can kind of tell, like, hey, when we first made our inspection cut, it was totally fine. There was no smoke, there was nothing. And now I'm making this kerf cut right where I'm gonna be standing when I cut this hole in the roof and there's fire blowing out of it, right? Maybe we know that we went a little bit too far. And while I'm on that topic, if we're ever walking and we see fire start blowing out of a roof, we are done. That's kind of a line, right? We never want to pass fire up on a roof. It just doesn't set ourselves up for success. So anyways, ongoing inspection cuts is going to be a kerf cut or a line. If you feel like you need to make them, make them. If you make it and you're like, I want to check this out more, make a triangle, whatever, just move with a purpose and know what you're actually doing here. Vent cuts. If we think about, again, what we're trying to do, we're trying to give that hot gas, smoke, a reason to leave. So we need to give it a big enough door. Typically, you want to make a 48-inch hole. And if we know enough about building construction, what is the spacing on most rafters on a roof?
Isn't it 24 inches?
Yeah, 24 on center. So if we think about making our cut, instead of pulling out the tape measure that everyone keeps in our bunker gear, we know that we've got 24 inches between studs, roughly, right? So if we want to make a 48-inch cut, we're going to do a center rafter cut, meaning we're going to cut from one rafter, roll over one rafter in the center until we hit another rafter, right? That's a center rafter cut, and we're just going to make a hole. You can kind of see that in that top picture there. When you see that OSB louvered out of the way, you see that kind of rafter beam sticking out of there. A double rafter cut, same thing, but we're rolling two rafters, so maybe we need to make a little bit bigger hole because our first hole isn't cutting it, whatever the reason is. If your IC asks for a bigger hole, do a double rafter cut. We're just going to roll two rafters and everything else is the same. So roof construction really helps us out here when we're trying to gauge how big we need our hole to be. So rolling one rafter is 48 inches. If we need a bigger hole, roll two. That last cut there is a trench cut. That's a defensive cut. So vent cuts are going to be offensive, meaning that we're aiding our engine companies and we're giving the fire a reason to leave. A trench cut is meant to not make the situation any worse. So that bottom picture is a pretty sweet trench cut in California. These are typically super useful on like multi family buildings, big apartment buildings where we've got fire on one half and we don't want it to keep spreading onto the other. So we can make this big trench cut across the entire roof and it basically serves as a fire break for the rest of that roof. Any questions on anything in terms of cuts, where you make them, stuff like that? All right.
Quick question on on starting like a kerf cut. How do you know exactly where to start it to say get your single center rafter cut? If you can't quite see, maybe from your inspection triangle.
Yeah, that's a good question. So for the kerf cut specifically, right, we just want that to be a really quick kind of slit in there. So it doesn't really matter where we make that cut. But I think another part of what you're asking too is how do we actually make that cut? So we're gonna watch a guy actually make cuts in the next video. But basically we don't wanna just plunge the saw into the roof, right? We wanna kind of start as close to horizontal as we can and start working our saw blade down into that roof. In terms of cutting for rafter spacing, a really good way to tell where your rafters are is if your dude who's sounding feels a rafter, and we already kind of talked about how you can't really feel rafters, but if you can, slam that tool in there and actually make a hole in the roof. If you can't, just hit really hard where you're going to cut, and 9 times out of 10 that tool will go through the roof. Now if we can't get any of those, it doesn't really matter, honestly. So we want to get a saw into the roof, right, horizontal. Once we drop that saw in, we can back cut until we hit a rafter, and then we know, hey, this is our starting point, let me finish this cut out and roll until I hit another rafter. Does that kind of make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. So it's just yeah, so you do a back cut until you hit a rafter and kind of know that's your start point, and then you'd roll over one rafter and that'd be 24 inches, and then you just go until you hit another rafter, and then that's your 48 inch, right?
Yeah, dead on. Any other questions in terms of cuts, tactics for vertical ventilation? Sweet. Let's watch a video on how it's done. I don't think you really need the sound for this one. But as we're going up, we are sounding. This guy has got a trash hook, super good tool. And he's on a pretty steep pitched roof. So he's kind of simulating using that roof ladder to keep his feet steady. He's going to take that saw from his officer or his clean out man behind him, and this dude's going to drive that into the decking. So that gives our saw firefighter a step to step out on and actually make his cuts. So he's going to start. You see how he didn't just plunge in, and there's a little back cut rolling a rafter to the other rafter, and now we've got our first cut done. I don't know how many people have played around with saws, but if you haven't, we'll do a lot of it. We've got brakes on them. That's that big bar in the front, the one in front of his hand, next to the bar he's holding onto. Anytime we don't have a chainsaw actively cutting, we want to try to break that saw. So we don't want to have our chain spinning as we're readjusting, as we're doing stuff like that. Just kind of break that saw as quickly as you can so that we don't cut ourselves by accident. So he's finishing his cut. Notice how his feet are positioned. So he doesn't have his feet in line with that saw at all. And the reason for that is if we slip, that saw is going to continue in a straight line, and we don't want to have our feet right in front of its path. So just keep stuff like that in mind when you're making your cuts. You saw right there, he got his roll on one rafter, and now he's gonna make his final cut. And basically what we've done right here is we've freed up the decking. So now he's gonna hand this saw back to the cleanout. Cleanout's talking on the radio. He's like, yeah, we made our cut. And this guy's like, sweet, I'm gonna pull this roof out. So he louvers this decking, and we're ready to go, right? This is kind of accomplishing what we've done. And now that's what punching the ceiling looks like, of course, after he's heard that the engine company is ready for it. Now they're all ready to head back down. Relatively quick operation, right? Another point that I wanted to hit on here is when you're readjusting, and this is gonna make a lot more sense once you can actually start handling a chainsaw, but if you can't grab that front bar super easily, just put the saw down like this guy has it right now. So break the saw, just put the blade down, and then grab that front brake and take it off if you need to. We always want to have a couple points of contact on the saw, right? Just holding it with one hand is typically not enough. So if you need to, ground that saw on the blade, reposition, do what you got to do, and then move down to make a second cut like this guy is if you want to make a second cut. Questions on what that was? Anything that he did there? This video didn't work for me, so I'm not even gonna try it again. But I can send it out if we want to look at it. So let's kind of just look at this a little bit more in action here. So we're up on a house fire. Building seems pretty clear, right? Let's keep watching this window and all the other windows. I think this might have been taken on a acquired structure training because it looks like some stuff is sort of constructed maybe to help them be safer, but you never know. So let's watch what's happening here. So one of the things that we noticed here, we've already kind of talked about. Does anyone see what that is? So if we look in through this window, this is where our fire is at, and we see smoke coming out of the middle of this roof here, right? So keep that in mind. Remember, this is one of our signs of failed decking. So let's kind of watch how this sort of plays out here. So let's just say they're waiting on the engine company to make their stretch here. All right, he's getting onto the roof. He did a better job of sounding than it looked like, I'm sure. And this is typically not the speed that we want to move, right? When we're getting on a roof, we typically want to be moving with a purpose. Don't just hang out and stand on the roof. That's not really helping anyone. All right, so we're moving to make our cut here. Oh, turns out our cut's already made, so he's just gonna pull this stuff back. And he punches through the ceiling, and look what happens kind of like immediately to this window in front of us, right? We're totally blacked down now, and we've got fire rolling out of the roof. Did anyone see that the movement in the window there? We were kind of talking about it a little bit. I'll rewind a little bit so we can try and see it. But watch that window. You guys see it flexing a little bit? And that smoke trying to breathe out of the building. And it breaks that window, smoke's pouring out, and we're gonna get a little smoke explosion. And there it is. So what happened? Why did we just see that kind of fire behavior?
You just quickly let in a bunch of oxygen through that window, and it kind of added fuel to the fire.
Yeah, for sure. Did you guys kind of catch what I was talking about with that window flexing, and we see that air kind of, or that fire kind of gasping for air? And then once he gives it to him exactly like what you're talking about, it gives it a huge influx of air, and we get that smoke explosion and rapid fire growth within this. Any questions about this video?
With those explosions, I was just kind of wondering, I mean, like, how much power can come out of those? Is it really like a strong explosion, or is it more fire just coming out of the side of the building?
That was probably the weakest one that I've ever seen, to be honest. these can be super powerful and really destructive. Like smoke explosions are a huge deal. Backdraft is a big deal. This was super tame, but they can be extremely powerful. So this is definitely something that we want to be aware of. And again, I think you guys will see better videos of that, hopefully, in your fire dynamics stuff once you get into that. Anything else? All right. All right, let's talk about some SizeUp stuff. So if you got your mic muted, let's just go off mute and let's just like have a chat here. I know we only have 10 minutes left and I want to be respectful of your time, but let's just kind of chat through some stuff really quickly. Cap and Chief, feel free to jump in if you got stuff to add. But let's kind of go through some of this stuff really quickly. So feel free to take yourselves off mute if I can figure out how to like get back to where I want it to be right there. And let's have a chat. So what do we see here? What's going on with this house? We got fire coming out of the top. Is there anything that we should take into consideration in terms of vertically venting this structure? Anyone seeing anything? And just feel free to talk.
You got the weak decking with the smoke coming out.
Yeah, I love it.
Nice. It's already vertically vented.
There you go.
Yeah.
I think that's what Chucky would say, but...
What was that, Cap?
I said that's not what a truckie would say, but you're right. It's already vertically vented, and if I look in my windows, I see pretty pristine drapes, which makes me think it's maybe just in the attic, and the rest of the building is searchable or savable.
Yeah. Yeah, so to kind of hit on what Cap was saying, yeah, like a truckie might say that this is not vertically vented. And to that point, right, if the engine company is in there to lift, we probably still do need to consider doing something up on this roof. My guess is that's probably not the case. To hit on what Cap said, also look at the windows, right? You can see in there the drapes look fine. So it kind of seems like we're pretty good here. Let's go on to the next one. So this is a picture of that waffling thing that I was talking about. Does everybody kind of see like what I'm talking about here, how we can see the rafter positions and how that roof is kind of just flopping over those rafters?
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, so this is sort of what that would look like. If you see this, it's probably something to consider when you're getting up on that roof. So on this, I want to hit on some kind of more higher level stuff. So we talked about taking victims into consideration here, right? So one of the ways that we can do that when we do our 360, meaning anytime we're coming around a building to get up on it, you want to just take a lap around, see what we can see. IC is going to do this when he first pulls up. We should do this as firefighters, kind of get a lay of the land, right? So we need to start learning how to read windows. So if we look at this house, it's super easy to tell where a couple main features are. Does anybody have a guess at where the kitchen is?
That
looks like it's probably on the Charlie side.
Yeah, like kind of by that slider, right?
Mm-hmm.
How about the bedrooms?
Looks like they might be on the upper level.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so if we think about bedrooms, right, they're typically going to be on the upper level, and we're usually going to have either those double framed windows like we see on that back seaside, or kind of just like a single framed window like we see on the Bravo side of this house. Also, we've got some kind of funky stuff happening on that Bravo side, right? We've got those three sort of diagonal windows. Anyone got a guess on what that's telling us is right there in that house?
Stairwell.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nailed it. Stairwell, right? So if you guys have older style houses, even a lot of newer style houses, you're going to have a window like three quarters of the way up your stairwell. So if we're walking around a house and we see a window at a weird spot on the side of the house, it's probably a stairwell, right? Cool, nailed it. Let's talk about this house for a little bit. So what do we see here in terms of reading windows? Like, what are we looking for here? Think about like bedrooms, bathrooms, stuff like that. Where are the stairs? All right, let's start with the stairs. We kind of had like a good thing going on that last slide. Who's got a guess at where the stairs are at on this house?
In the center behind that middle window on the alpha side.
Yeah, could be.
Yeah, I'm thinking stairs are interior.
Yeah, I'd agree with you. I'd say they're probably going to be on this Bravo side because we don't see a whole lot of windows happening there. So that can mean a couple of things, right? Maybe we've got like a closet or something. If that double pane window is a bedroom, maybe that's a closet on that Bravo side. But yeah, it looks like we've got kind of like a big living room type structure going on in the center of this house. So something to keep in mind. This is my beautiful house that is painted orange and yellow, disgusting color for some reason, but whatever. This is a pretty typical construction of this style of house. So we've got this big bay window on that first floor, and then we've got that little window on the left to the door. That door favors the right side of the house. So now that I actually know the answer, can you guys tell me where the stairs are at, where the living room is in this house, and what that window is on the second floor?
I'm going to say their living room is on the right.
Yeah, what makes you say that?
It just looks like it's a pretty large window, and maybe this is very like simple way of looking at it, but it seems like to me, at least typically larger windows is usually to like a larger room. So I just think and it's going to be used as letting light in the house as well. So that just would lead me to believe that that's a living room.
Yeah, nailed it. Anyone else?
Your stairs are probably on the left, like that other house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally. So this type of construction with this little window, door favoring one side of the house, and a big window is going to give you the entire layout of that house. So this is super important if we're going up on the roof, if we're an engine company. Really if we're doing anything on this scene. So now we know when the engine company gets to the top of the stairs and they say, hey, the fire's right here, well, we know where that's at without even going in the house, right? A couple more. This one shows a pretty good view of those rafter tails I was talking about. We had a live look in, so we won't kind of dwell on this for too long, but it gives you an idea, right, of what kind of wood is used to build those, how they run, what the spacing is, stuff like that. What are we looking at here? What type of construction is this?
Looks like a dream home.
Yeah, right? A little bit drafty, but nothing we can't work with.
Balloon?
Yeah, we're looking at balloon frame construction. So Look at these studs. They literally span the entire house up to the roof. So if we get a fire on this first floor, there's really nothing that's stopping that fire from riding those studs all the way up into the roof. This is typically what a balloon framed house is going to look like from the outside. So older style house, you can tell not only by that super old sweet jag in the driveway, but also because everything is lined up in this house. Look at all of the windows, all of the doors, they're all in line with each other. That's not an end all be all for balloon frame, but it's a pretty good indication that we could be working with something that looks like this, right? It's easier to frame those out going kind of vertically all in line with each other. Questions on balloon frames, how they actually look. So let's just quickly hit on platform and then we'll do one fire and then I'll let you guys go. I could talk for a while on ventilation, but I'll keep it quick. So this is typically what a platform is gonna look like. So we can see we've got those fire stops in there. It's made from engineered wood. Again, if you don't know what that is, let me know. I can send you some stuff or you can look it up. But basically it burns quicker. It's less wood, but not really the point of this picture. The point is that we've got those fire stops in between floors 1 and 2. So let's hit this fire really quick and then you guys can be done. So what do we think here? If you're the IC coming up onto this call, what are your thoughts in terms of vertical ventilation? All right, I'll help you out. Fire's in the garage, right? How does the rest of the house look?
I think the rest of the house looks like it's still in pretty good shape. I think if you were to vent the roof, it might pull the fire up through the house. You might just, in turn, be making more damage.
Yeah. What else we got?
What about your bedroom directly over the garage?
Yeah, what do we think about that?
Searchable.
Totally. So as we kind of hit on here, right, for the sake of the garage, you probably don't need a whole lot of ventilation going on here, right? It's already venting itself out of that garage door. So it's sort of pointless to get up on top of that garage and make a cut, right? What Chief mentioned was that bedroom right above the garage. That is a pretty prime location to look for people in. It looks pretty searchable. We probably don't need to get up on the roof and make a big hole, but that's kind of what we're rocking with here, right? So this fire has pretty much vented itself out of the garage. We probably don't need to head up onto the roof and make a cut or turn a fan on here, if that makes sense.
The other thing Tommy mentioned that we look at when we do a size up is the smoke. So right. Why is the smoke real thick and black, or you know, why is it black in general in a garage?
You got cars in there and gasoline, lots of stuff for it to burn.
Incomplete combustion.
Right. You know, lots of plastics. I don't know what your garage looks like, but I got a shelf that hangs from the ceiling and there's coolers up there and some skis and snowboards and stuff like that. So like Tommy said, you're already self-vented because the garage door is open, and now I just have all that nasty stuff that's in all of our garages burning and creating that smoke, but the rest of the building looks pretty solid. in the more you learn about building construction, that usually finished garages are at least the threshold, and the door that goes into the house is engineered so that it burns longer before it'll fail. It's more like double sheeting of drywall, things like that, because they know that a garage can burn really hot and they want to protect the rest of the house and the occupants. So I think Tommy kind of nailed it, as not a real big need to vertically vent, and you can easily search that building and get a few lines into the garage to knock it down and then clean up and hopefully just have to repair the garage.
For sure. Good stuff. All right, I'm just going to put this up on the screen. Questions on anything that we hit on tonight? I could keep going, but I know you guys probably don't want to. If you got questions, let me know. Otherwise, I'm going to sneak this last one in because we were talking about smoke and it's an awesome picture. So first, before we do that, questions before I let you guys go.
Yeah, just one quick one about the balloon framed houses. If you're doing like rescue and you got victims trapped in those houses, what's probably the best way to do that if it's going to spread really quickly?
So you kind of got to let your tactics dictate that, right? So I mean, it's kind of hard to say without having sort of a scenario, but this is going to be like any other rescue, right? Our goal of getting people out of a house is quick, down, and dirty, right? There's a lot of drags and stuff you can start practicing, but at the end of the day, we need to get our hands on that person. We need to get them out of the house. So if you have a balloon frame type house, yeah, that's probably something to consider, that you need to move a little bit quicker. But it's also not an excuse to move without a purpose, or to move rapidly and mess stuff up, right? So if we've got a balloon frame, maybe sheltering in place is not a super good option. I don't think you guys have hit on search yet, so I won't expand on that too much, but sheltering in place is basically a tactic saying, well, we've gotten to this victim, it's going to be really hard to get them down four flights of stairs and out the door because they weigh 350 pounds. So instead, we're just going to close the door to the bedroom and hang out, right? That might be less viable of an option if we're in a balloon frame, because we know that fire can move up to the roof quickly. Again, tactics and conditions are going to kind of conditions are going to kind of drive your tactics in terms of getting people out of the house. The same as honestly anything would be for like fire attack or anything else. I don't know if anyone wants to add anything else onto that. All right. Let's
cool. Thanks.
Start. Yeah, for sure. Anyone else have any other questions before we chat about this for a minute, and then I'll let you guys go? Sweet. All right. We're just going to rapid fire some questions off, and we'll give you like, well, whatever. You guys can dictate this, right? You get to leave after this one's over. So where is this fire? And if you guys can't answer for a while, we'll let Chief and Cap jump in here. But where is this fire in this house?
I think it looks like it's just on the, I guess it would be the Bravo side, on the other side of that brick wall there, where the smoke's coming out of the top, on the peak there on the left.
Yeah, totally. And what part of the house would that be if we're talking about building construction?
Looks like it might be like a living room.
Could be. Let's look kind of specifically where this fire is venting itself out, right? This is an attic, probably a cock loft. We've got smoke pouring out of the vent at the end of the house. So now that we know that this fire is in the attic, right, we can see into those windows. It looks like it's probably not anywhere down into the house. Is this a good roof to get up onto? Why or why not?
Probably not a good roof to get on top because you got smoke coming out of it. So it's probably through the decking like you're talking about. And I don't know, it might be burning through those materials underneath.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, I will add on to that really quick and then we'll let you go. Let's think about what we're doing when we vertically ventilate, right? We're making life easy for the engine company. Is life already easy for them? Yeah, probably in this fire, right? We can look inside this house. They don't really need a whole lot of lift to get in and go where they're going. This also isn't really impacting victims unless we got someone sleeping in that crawl space for some reason. Could happen. But if we go up onto this roof, we're risking ourselves because this roof is not super strong if there's fire under it already. We're also not really accomplishing anything. Like, if we move that smoke and combustion to move up an extra foot, what is that really buying us? The risk isn't really worth the payout here. So let's keep stuff like that in mind when we're coming into fires, and you guys will start kind of recognizing more of these scenes as you start seeing more of it. So thank you guys for listening. If you have any other questions, I'll hang out for a little bit. Feel free to email me if you didn't understand stuff. Give me a call, whatever. Cap, I don't know if you have anything to